I was a kid, dude, I wanted to go to GIT so bad, man. And it just didn't happen because my parents just couldn't afford it. I mean, you know, GIT is not, it's not a, they don't have dorms. It's not like a regular college or anything like that. At least it wasn't back then, you know, because this would have been for me.
Now it's a college. Now it's a college, but I don't think it was until the early 2000s.
It was just a trade school back when I was going to go. Yeah. And it was probably like 87 or 88 when I wanted to go, you know what I mean? Long time ago. And that was, but that's when Paul Gilbert was teaching there. That's when Frank Gambale was there and Scott Henderson and, you know, all the heavy hitters, Jeff Berlin was there and, you know, and everybody was coming through. Not knowing theory and that stuff, it's a terrifying thought. I can't imagine not knowing it and just kind of relying just solely upon my ear to figure something out in the on the fly of the moment or whatever, you know?
There's people that can do that, but I'm not one. You know, I'm definitely not one of them. And especially now, like the older I get, the more that I hear the intervals more and more clearly, you know, sure. So when I hear a song on the radio and I'm like, that was a very clear, you know, fourth right there.
Right.
Yeah. When that starts happening, I think, what if I didn't know what a fourth sounds like?
Right.
How would I hear this? You know, how would I identify what I'm hearing?
Exactly.
You know, the other day I had a, not an argument, but like a healthy discussion with a musician that I play with, a pro that believes that you don't need theory, that believes that it's all about the heart and all that. And he starts telling me about how theory gets in the way of his playing. And I'm like, wait a second, dude, no. Like,
no.
You play a power chord because you know it's a fifth that doesn't sound any different. You know, like, because he's like, oh, because I like to play. He started playing a bunch of power chords. And I was like, okay, you're playing parallel fifths. The fact that you know that you're playing parallel fifths doesn't make it less powerful, you know?
Yeah. Like,
and then he else, I'm like, you're playing a triad. He was doing the Van Halen tapping thing. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, that is a triad, root, third, fifth, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, the knowledge that you're doing that doesn't make it any different.
Right. Yeah.
But knowing what you are doing does make a difference for you. You know?
It makes a huge difference and it opens up the possibilities of more things you can do with that information.
Well, on this part of my song, I want the song go from happy to sad.
Right.
So instead of like writing major right here, I'm going to put a chord progression that goes through the triad. That's
right.
But I know exactly what's going to sound like. You know?
Yeah, very true. I like with my students, sometimes, you know, I have to kind of coax them into learning theory. And I tell them it's kind of like this. I said, to me, not knowing theory, it's kind of like getting dropped off in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the night with nothing and told to find your way home. You know, if you don't get eaten by wolverines or bears or some shit and you happen to make it home, you're lucky. But if you get dropped off out there in that same situation, you got flashlight, GPS, a phone, you know, you can get yourself out of there. That's like what knowing theory is like. Or imagine, you know, there's another one I use. Imagine not, you know, being able to read the English language, right? So you can't read street signs. You can't sit down at a restaurant and open up the menu and, you know, what are you going to ask for? A picture book to, you know, that's what not knowing theory is how I compare it to, you know what I mean? It's like, how do you function? You know? But I mean, there's plenty of great players out there that don't know theory and do great. And sometimes you're amazed to find out when somebody that you really like and plays great doesn't know anything about what they're doing. It's like, wow. You know,
I think two examples of that would be like Eddie Van Halen and like George Lynch. You know,
well, Eddie knew a lot of more theory than he, I don't know if he didn't lead on to knowing theory, but he knew his shit.
For example, he knew he was playing arpeggio triads on Eruption when people had no idea what triads were.
Guitar
players, you know, like that. Yeah. It's all a point in time. Nowadays, man, and this is one thing I say too. There's a lot. Eddie Van Halen is not an example, but there's other guitar players that get so much praise, and I'm like, well, no. He just understood a little bit more theory than everybody else in 1984. You know, it's like he's not that good, but you know, like there's a whole generation of guitar players that think that know theory as much theory to understand what Randy Rhoads did, and he kind of stops there. You know, like they know the harmonic minor scale, but they don't know the melodic minor. It's a very interesting thing because it's. I mean, I cannot imagine theory hurting unless you're like trying to. Things fit.
It's like a rule book or something.
Yeah. But even then, like, experience teaches you that that doesn't work like that.
Yeah. You can't. Yeah, I tell my students, it's like theory is just a way to understand what it is that you've created, what it is you're hearing. I can give my mom a theory book. She can read it and understand it, but she can't play a note on any instrument, but it's understandable. You know, you can, you know, comprehend this information. And then what you do with it is limitless. I mean, it opens your mind up to more and more possibilities that you might not have ever thought of you could even do or even try.
You're like the reason that I got into theory. Yeah. Because I read it in a magazine. It was like Guitar World or something. It was in the back and it had like a little photo of you and it was all this cool stuff. And I didn't understand any of the words, Lydian, Mixolydian. Like, I didn't know any of that at the time. Mm-hmm. And then your quote on top was something like, I can't remember exactly what it was, but like, you were like, theory isn't going to stunt your playing. And that's what I had in my head.
Yeah.
And you're like, theory doesn't stunt my playing. It gives me all the right tools to get where I want to go or something like that. And mm-hmm. It's just like, I was like, wow, if this guy's like kind of knows his stuff, I want to know what Mixolydian means and Lydian. And
right. The
one thing that I would say about like my students though, where it does flip a bit is where they 100% like, you know, they dove into like, they want to learn how to solo. And all they want to do is learn the modes. And you're like, well, what are you going to do with them? Yeah. Well, I just want to learn the patterns. And it's like, then they learn the theory of it, but they don't apply it to anything. And then they go, why does my playing still suck? It's like, well, I mean, yeah, you can know what it means too. But if you haven't sat and like jammed with it a little bit, you know, just put a Lydian or put like an E major track on and jam Lydian, jam Mixolydian, and then jam some other ones and just see how all those different notes, you know, come together.
Yeah. That concept right there, what you just said right there is amazing, how the amount of guitar players that don't even get to that, you know, mm-hmm. they get, oh, this is my Ionian, this is my Dorian, this is my Phrygian. You know,
yeah, it's funny because
to stay at different spots.
Yeah, I'm primarily a self-taught guitar player, so I taught myself all the modes. I taught myself like through Metal Method and stuff like that. So I taught myself the modes and stuff like that, and there was a lot of missing things because when I started trying to improvise, I thought of all the modes, like, you know, major, Dorian, Phrygian, etc. I thought when I was in that position, I was playing a Phrygian, like if I'm in the Phrygian position.
Yeah.
If I'm in the Lydian position, I thought I was playing a Lydian, like, so I'd come up with all these licks that I thought were mode X or whatever, and it's completely wrong, you know. So when I'm trying to play over backing tracks, well, I'm in key, but everything sounds wrong, you know, hitting the wrong target tones and things like that. So it took a while to, you know, because I developed my chops early on, but I didn't understand how to apply it, even though I knew theory, but I still didn't understand how chords and the modes actually function individually. Or if you're playing over G major chord progression, all seven positions are now G major, they're not the mode name anymore. Yep. It's like pentatonic pattern 1 through 5. You don't give them, you know, each one doesn't have a specific mode name. It's just box 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know? Mm-hmm. So when you're in a mode, it's box 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you know, cause you're not in that mode. It's like, you know, sometimes.
Oh, so you just keep it all, like say all G major, you're just playing it. Right. So consider it a new mode.
No, if I'm in playing, if I'm in G major, the whole fretboard from open to 24 is that's all G major. In any way you slice it up, it's only becomes a mode when you change the chord progression to outline the sound of that mode. Then the whole fretboard becomes that mode. So with a lot of my students that I have a hard time grasping that, I'll print out the modes 7 times, all in the same key, and just highlight a different root note. And they'll go, well, these are all the same. It's like, well, that's what I've been trying to tell you. It's all the same, but you got to change the emphasis of where the root note's at. You know, it's not a mode until you play it over that mode's progression. It's like, tell them to play all the modes parallel. Play G major, G Dorian, G Phrygian, G Lydian. And then tell me it's the same. It's not. Yeah. That's because when you hear the modes parallel from a beginning standpoint, that's when you really hear the modes. Because when you learn them, you know, I teach the modes in the derivative approach first, because who wants to learn 7 keys at once by doing them parallel, right? That's not a good way to learn the modes. So as I'm teaching the modes, the derivative approach all from one key, then I'll start playing them all parallel so that they can actually hear the difference. Because until you play all the modes over a specific chord progression, they all just sound like the major scale to a certain extent until you know how to use them, right? So, but as soon as you play them parallel, then it's like, oh, that's like day and night. Like I'll do something like this, just with the clean tone. Let me see if I find a pick. I would do like an E drone and just play like an octave. Here's the major scale. Okay, so now let's listen to E Phrygian. And then they're like instantly, it's like, oh yeah, that doesn't sound anything alike. You know what I mean? So when you play in parallel Lydian. right? And it's when you can, a student, you know, in the beginning phases, hears them parallel, that's when they finally get it. Cause you know, if you run all the modes in one key, they just kind of do sound like G major until you figure out how that works.